Good morning. Welcome to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Granick, your host. Another beautiful week, another beautiful day in West Georgia. And we've got a great show lined up for you today. Jared Craig, he's running for U.S. Congress, 3rd District. And let's see, let me be sure, the website, it's jaredcraigforgeorgia.com, and you spell out Georgia. It's House District 3rd, number 3, 3rd District. And Jared, good morning.
Good morning. How you doing?
Well, usually on these shows, I'm doing fine, thank you. Hope you're well. Usually on these shows, I kind of read a bio, but I've gotten to where I like better for the guest, in your case, the candidate for Congress, just to introduce yourself to the people of our audience. Obviously, you got some strong ties to West Georgia. Just tell us a little something about yourself.
Sure. I'm a lifetime Georgia resident. I was born and raised in the state of Georgia. And my family is in Coweta County, where we have a old family farm that's turned into basically a subdivision of family. My family's been here for a good long time. I am married. This next week, I'll be married 19 years. I have two young daughters, ages 10 and 6, who have attend public school. But I'm a product of the public school system. I went to East Coweta High School, and then I attended West Georgia College, or University of West Georgia here in Carrollton, and graduated from the Richards College of Business in 2006. After that point, I then attended and graduated from Atlanta's John Marshall Law School in 2009, and for the past 12 years or more, I have practiced family law and a general practice law firm out of Coweta County, Georgia. And that's given me a good cross-section of who the people of District 3 are. I have a hands-on approach to, one, knowing the people, two, being part of the people, and three, having a lot of things in common. So I don't see myself as a career politician, but I am a career advocate, and that's why I come to this race as an advocate for the people of District 3.
Well, you know, it sounds like you got a good life. If you're elected to Congress, that life's going to get turned upside down. So why are you running?
Well, I see it as a sacrifice. I think that when you become a public servant, you are putting yourself out there to take some attacks because you got to do the work that is necessary to be done. And part of the reason why I jumped into this race is because I was looking at who was representing us and who was doing the job or supposed to do the job that they were elected to do. And as I went around District 3, it's 15-county district, I learned there's two responses that are most common. One is, who represents me? I don't know. They didn't know who Drew Ferguson is. And two, they're still waiting on a phone call back. They've been ghosted for some reason. And he has, I think, underrepresented the people of District 3, partially because I'm not sure how qualified he is to hold that seat.
Well, he hasn't appeared on this show after he was elected. Yeah, he's been in office, what, 6 years now, approximately?
Yes, he's already served 3 terms. This would be his 4th term he's running for now.
Well, we're going to get more into the politics of it all coming up, but we're going to take a break, then we'll come back when jump into a few of the issues of the day. But first, this word from Tanner Health System and Oak Mountain Academy.
I'm Michael Flynn, Oak Mountain Academy class of 1978.
Katie Flynn, class of 2010.
Justin Flynn, class of 2014.
Logan Flynn, class of 2019.
And I'm Marnie Flynn, current teacher at OMA.
My uncle Richard Orme Flynn, a founding father of Oak Mountain Academy, had a vision to see students become confident leaders who hold a faith-based value system in an academically rigorous environment. We are proud to celebrate 60 years of fulfilling my uncle's vision.
Our family invites you to visit the campus or oakmountain.us today.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
Yeah, Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. Jared Craig is a congressional candidate for the 3rd District. Jared Craig for Georgia.com, and Georgia is spelled out. You know, when Biden, Joe Biden took office, the average price of a gallon of gas was $2.19. Now it's hovering around $4 or so. Price of a barrel of oil was $49. Now it's $100 or so. And inflation was 2% when President Biden took office. Now it's around 10%. So what kind of impact do you see this having on Americans?
I see this as a horrible impact on Americans. Part of my platform, it goes through many, many issues, but everything gravitates towards energy independence, that if we can't get the economy back on track, we can't meet any of our other goals. One of my main goals is critical manufacturing of goods and services, or primarily goods, in the United States, that we no longer rely on countries like China for our pharmaceuticals, our building supplies, and some of our technology. So until we get energy squared away, we're not going to be able to reach our benchmarks for any of the other platform issues. I think that the way that Biden shut off the fossil fuels without replacing it with anything was a little premature, or actually very premature, and he has sent us in a tailspin on energy costs that affects every single good that's transported from China, from any other country, through our ports and then into distribution. Gas affects all of us. It's inflation affects all of us, and gas is the first indicator of inflation. I don't see the Biden administration doing anything to curb this inflation. It's almost invited. So I think that what we need to do is get a stranglehold on our economy and get it to where we are mining for ore, drilling for gas, fracking, getting what our natural resources can provide to us without us having to rely on countries like Iran, Venezuela, and begging countries that we seem to be at odds with to supply our energy supply.
They say the extra gas cost for the average person is an extra $1,200 a year, which is pretty significant for most everybody. When Joe Biden took office, the U.S. Customs and Border Patrol reported 405,000 total encounters for the fiscal year 2020. The CBP fiscal year runs from October to September. Now for this fiscal year, 2022, year to date, the number is double at 805,000 total encounters. How dangerous is that, particularly in the fact that it looks like Title 42 may be revoked on May 23rd, and it's estimated upwards of 18,000 border crossings per day?
Well, it's dangerous for several reasons. One, we're getting fentanyl poured across our border that's originating in China, manufactured or otherwise distributed in Mexico, and sent across our southern border. Second of all, the invasion of undocumented migrants, whatever you'd like to call them, they're coming here, and I believe that they're being allowed to vote in a lot of places where there's no voter ID. So it's affecting our vote integrity. And we don't know who's coming across the southern border for a safety issue. It's a national security issue. There have been people from more than South America coming across the southern border. I believe there's over 150 different countries.
Correct.
Of people.
127 is what I read.
127. Correct me. But that's way too many people that are coming across our border from all over the world, and they're learning if you want to get into the U.S. unchecked, come across the southern border. I think we need to finish the wall. We need to enforce the laws that are currently on the books. And the beautiful thing with the immigration is we already have laws that are being ignored, that all we have to do is fund them, fund the Border Patrol, fund ICE, so they can do their jobs. They've been demonized to where the morale on the border is horrible. But if we just fund the people who are supposed to be guarding the border and complete the wall and follow the laws that are already on the books, we could nip this in the bud real quickly.
You probably saw where Texas Ranger Bishop Evans lost his life trying to save two people crossing the border, and it turned out they were running drugs.
I did.
That's a pretty tragic situation.
And there's a bunch of stories that way. They demonize the Border Patrol, but they are good people. They're not trying to cause harm to those crossing the border. They're right now they're humanitarian. The border is being hit with coyotes and human trafficking. there's tons of problems with an open border. If you travel anywhere in the world, there's no such thing anywhere else. And if we can't control who comes and goes out of our country, I'm not sure what we're doing. Are we a country?
I want to kind of shift gears for a second on this next question, and we'll kind of shift back into the political world. But I noticed on your website the manufacturing is very important to you, and certainly in the West Georgia area. We saw NAFTA pretty much destroy the textile base in Bremen in the early 90s. It was a pretty horrific thing. And now it seems like it's hard to maintain a workforce post-COVID. And if America does not go back to work, particularly in manufacturing, will we become some country like Japan, which is really unable to maintain their economy?
I think that we're seeing signs of that right now. We need to get back to manufacturing for several reasons. It brings jobs. We have the labor here. We need to motivate them that life can be better than the standard of living from subsidy life, that they can have some self-respect from having a job, being proud of the work that they do right here in the United States, having a product that they create right here in the United States. We don't have the wealth of our nation siphoned off to China or some other country. So I think that we need to do a 180 on this. We have become over-globalized in our markets. We don't produce anything here. And we have the infrastructure, not only in Carroll County, but all over Georgia, where there are sites where they've been shut down. They have access to water, transportation, and they're ready to go. We just need to upgrade some of them, modernize them, but we could be producing computer chips, pharmaceuticals, all kinds of things in a relatively short period of time.
But in order to do that, you have to maintain a strong work ethic, do you not?
Yes, you do. And I believe that starts at home. That takes a lot more work
growing up on a farm, you probably saw some of that.
Yes, we never were bored. We were never allowed to be bored because there's always something to do on a farm.
I'm going to start jumping around, so stay with me. Obviously, in the governor's race, election integrity, and well, basically in all races, it seems like election integrity is a big issue. This week, there's a film coming out where you can find out more about it, 2000mules.com, which is talking about the high number of absentee ballots in Georgia that were fraudulently taken to drop boxes by, allegedly 250 mules in Georgia. What's your thinking upon that and election integrity overall?
Well, first off, I want to make it clear that this is a state-level issue. The federal government has no place in stepping on the toes of the state actors in every state as to how they handle their federal elections. But at the state level, what we need to do is get trust in the system. I firmly believe that those machines, we need to get rid of them. Go back to paper ballots, where it's verifiable paper, counted pages. We have it regulated with the ink, the paper, the stamp, the watermark, everything along those lines. But we also need to have the people in charge not asleep at the wheel. I firmly believe that we need to have a strong Secretary of State. Jody Heiss is who I'm endorsing. And we also need to replace the Attorney General. The Attorney General is who advises the Secretary of State directly. And I think that Chris Carr is also not doing the best job. I would support a John Gordon to take that position. And lastly, we need to have a strong governor. And I don't think Brian Kemp is the strong governor that we need in the state of Georgia. I support David Perdue.
Okay, like I said, I'm going to jump around. There's kind of a little known or best kept secret where in the Constitution it says that all revenue bills are to originate in the U.S. House. So theoretically, basically, if we want to want to rein in government spending or the deficit or even the debt, the U.S. House of Representatives could do so if they had the will to do so. Am I wrong or right about that?
You're correct that the House controls the purse. That what the problem has been is the unbalanced budget, to where you have things that are funded that are never stopped, that are patting the pockets of some of the politicians, special interest projects and things here and there that we all have heard many add-on amendments that are laughable. But we need to go through and see, what do you need? which is an antiquated process? What kind of programs need to be stopped? I'm all in favor of auditing the effectiveness and efficiency of the different departments that are being funded in the projects, because there's tons of things out there that Americans don't know about that we're paying for, and I believe that's stealing from us. So I think we could go to single-issue bills to avoid that going forward and focus on a balanced budget. If we don't balance our budget at home, we cut corners. The government's no different. We should make ends meet before we start increasing our costs.
So if the House did its job, we wouldn't need a balanced budget amendment, correct?
That's right. It seems to be inherent in the job of setting a budget to make it balanced.
74 of the top 100 officials in the Biden administration were part of the Obama administration. 60% of the Biden administration cabinet officials are part of the Obama administration. Effectively, is this Obama's third term and a continuation of the fundamental transformation of America?
There's a lot of speculation as to who's pulling Biden's puppet strings. And I think what seems most logical conclusion is look at what's happening now as a continuation of the Obama administration. And either someone, if not Obama himself, might be in charge of our country right now by proxy. But if you look at who's currently in the administration, like you said, 74 of the top 100, if you don't change your staff, are you a different administration? And I don't think so. And it might be out of a necessity. Who would Biden otherwise rely on? Yeah. He doesn't have a strong following. I'm not sure what Biden's plans are, or if he has any plans whatsoever, but I actually do believe that Obama has a hand in some of the consulting, if not advising, of the Biden administration.
Well, one quick example is on April 21st and 6 days later, after a speech by Obama regarding bringing greater censorship in by the big tech companies, the Disinformation Governance Board was created. So
fact checkers.
Yeah, the quote-unquote Ministry of Truth, as conservatives would call it. Anyway, we're going to take a break. We'll come back with more. And we're on Facebook Live on 1330 AM, 106.3 FM. And we got Jared Craig. He's running for Congress, 3rd District. Jared Craig for Georgia.com. We'll be back with more after this.
As a believer in the power of education, we are called to set the standard by shaping and empowering the minds of future generations through quality education. Oak Mountain Academy embraces this philosophy, which is why my children attend this prestigious school. I am elated to serve on the OMA Board of Trustees, where together we prepare students and remind them to trust and believe in the power to transform the world. I'm Dr. Brian Bain, inviting you to celebrate our 60-year legacy of academic excellence. Visit us at oakmountain.us.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. Delighted to have you with us. Jared Craig, U.S. Congress candidate, 3rd District. Jared Craig for Congress.com. He's with us this morning. And on Facebook Live, we have a question from Leslie McPherson. Question is, if elected, will you be doing town hall meetings in the district and be accessible to the people when they contact you? Currently, we have an absent congressman.
That is a thing I've been asked a lot, and I am happy to have town halls. I started this race in July of last year, and I have been in every county going constantly. I met Drew Ferguson the first time about 2 weeks ago at the Cherokee Rose Gun Club, and it was about a 5-minute speech, and he was gone. We actually had a debate set up a week and a half ago, and he no-showed. So I understand
that. Now, do you win a debate if your opponent doesn't show?
I take it that way, yes.
I mean, is that like the tree in the forest? If the you know, nobody hears it, I mean, do you automatically win?
Well, with this, there was a lot of coverage. A lot of people saw and heard this one. But I promise the people of this district that in between sessions, I will come down and do town halls. I love it. That's how I've turned a lot of my speaking engagements from just a speaking from a podium to an open forum. Because,
well, I'm sure the incumbent would say, well, we had COVID. He couldn't do it. And he did virtual or whatever.
Well, from what I've heard, he does phone town halls where about five people listen to one person speak. And it doesn't really have an interaction. It's laughable how out of touch he is. He recently posted something saying that he was doing district work in Cartersville at the Anheuser-Busch plant. I think he's a little north of the northern border is 52 miles from that plant of District 3. So I think
that's just too easy. I'm not going to engage on that. Keep going.
He's out of touch by 52 miles. So, but I really enjoy engaging the people here.
Yeah.
As an advocate and an attorney, I love speaking with people. That's how I get my job done. And I don't think that I would be representing the people of District 3 if I didn't listen to them.
But your chances of winning, the incumbent has, I looked it up, or we looked it up, it has basically $750,000 in his campaign account, cash on hand. How in the world can anybody beat that?
Well, I'll tell you, I've had some polls I've done, and I've been around. I've worn out a pair of shoes going around, and what I've found is my biggest hurdle is name recognition, as with any incumbent race. On message, I'm about 80-20, 70-30 at lowest on the polls as to what my platform is versus his voting history. But name recognition, I don't want to be the not Drew Ferguson candidate. I want to be the pro Jared Craig candidate for District 3. And I have taken every measure I can to get out and share the message with as many people as possible. And what I've found is that people are thirsty for change. The red wave that's coming through this year, people are universally looking for a change. And there's a thought that if you were in office for the last 6 years and you weren't part of the solution, you must be part of the problem. So people want a fresh voice. They want a fresh set of ideas. They want an energetic representative, and I believe I can provide that for them. I do have an uphill battle with name recognition, but that's why I'm here today.
Well, that's a good point, and I appreciate you coming in. Like I said, the incumbent has not in the last 6 years.
And no amount of money can turn a bad message good.
Well, I want to ask you about this. You've met President Donald Trump, correct?
That's right.
What was your impression of him?
Well, I had the pleasure of going down to Mar-a-Lago in mid-February, I believe it was February 17th, and I had a chance to meet with him and speaking with him about this race specifically for about 5 minutes at most. My impression was he is very energetic. He is very warm. A lot of people thought that he was going to be very aggressive and abrasive and cold, but he was very open to the discussion with all the candidates who were down there. I felt that he seemed to have a grasp on who everybody was and what was important in the races, and I really think that he's energetic and ready to do something big in 2024.
Okay. Now, let's mention, I think we certainly should mention, I assume you're very pro-Second Amendment?
Yes, I am.
Also understand you're very pro-life?
I am.
And that's a whole nother show.
Those kind of go together.
Yeah, exactly. Well, there's one other thing that goes together, too, and I think it's relatable to this race. We mentioned about the Disinformation Governance Board. Basically, there are five freedoms in the First Amendment, freedom of the press, freedom of speech included. But if freedom of the press and freedom of the speech go away, there's nothing to hold government accountable, because all the communications directors and press secretaries in the world, they're going to spin it in favor of their boss. So how important are those two freedoms in your mind?
Well, they're in the First Amendment because I believe they're the most important. And I couple the First Amendment, freedom of speech and religion, as one single right. And I know it's broken down in there, but it was intended for the freedom of speech to include the freedom of religion. And I say it a lot that you should be free to exercise your religion 7 days a week. the censorship that we've seen from media, social media, and even HR departments on the smaller scale, I believe stymies that right, stymies the spirit of the American people into a secular monolith.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's healthy for the people. I want more speech. That's the solution to many of our problems. Our country was founded on fleeing from tyranny and shutting down the communication, false information. That's how tyrants start. That's, if you look in the history of all fascists and communist leaders, they start with communications.
That's why this disinformation governance board is concerning, and certainly the role of big tech is also concerning. There's a lot I want to talk to you about. In just 60 seconds, because I know this is a big topic, but in Georgia and across America, we've seen parental rights bills. We've seen the introduction to a greater or lesser degree on where you live in the country of what I call the wicked critical race theory. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, first off, I think education and parental rights is a state issue. Once again, to bring attention to where federal overreach has been rampant in our culture for decades, if not hundreds of years now. I think critical race theory is poisonous. I don't want my children going to school thinking that anyone is lesser or better than the other, and based upon immutable traits like skin color, national origin. I think that the other poison pill that's going on in schools is the transgender movement, and trying to force that on children before they have any concept of sexuality whatsoever, as little as third grade or kindergarten in some districts. I think that what we need to do is empower parents. In the Supreme Court, there have been cases that identify as part of the privacy rights that a parent has the right to make decisions for their children. And part of that decision making should include what they're taught in schools, or at least be aware of what they're being taught in schools, so they can participate in the process and the school boards.
We always like to conclude a program by saying, okay, you've knocked on my door. I tell you, you've got 60 seconds. Ask for my vote.
Well, I ask for your vote for several reasons. I believe I'm more qualified. I'm a constitutional scholar. I work with the law, the federal law, state law, regularly. I speak legalese. I'm trained legalese, and I'm an advocate for the people of District 3. The same area that I have practiced primarily for my private practice is the same area of District 3. It wasn't set up that way on purpose. It's just coincidental that way. So I think that the people of District 3 deserve better. I believe that the people of District 3 have been underrepresented by the current Drew Ferguson congressman holding the seat. And I think I can do a better job. I'm willing to do the job no one's doing. So get out on the – I think today starts early voting. But get out whenever you can and vote. And we need to take back D.C. from not only the Democrats, but also the rhinos, the Republicans who are set to do just as much damage as the liberal Democrats.
Our guest this morning has been Jared Craig. He's running for Congress in the 3rd District in the Republican primary. His website is jaredcraigforgeorgia.com, and Georgia is spelled out. Mr. Craig, thank you for coming in.
It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure. And we hope to see you back soon. And we thank everyone for listening to the Community Voice here on WLBB Carrollton.